That's going to be fun. Actually, I have two presentations with me. And, well, one of those was not yet public when I wrote my, you know, text for the call for papers, because that's what we announced about 1.5 weeks ago. And I kind of want to ask all of you, with a show of hands, what you want to see. Well, I'm going to try and do both presentations, but obviously that's not going to fit. So I'm going to ask all of you what you want to see first, namely the presentation of Nextcloud Hub, which is the new thing that we announced 1.5 weeks ago. Or should that start with the presentation of the, you know, some apps, essentially, of Nextcloud? So who would like to first hear more about this Nextcloud Hub thing that we introduced? Hands. Okay. And who would prefer the apps stuff first? You make it terribly hard because it seems to be a 50-50. Well, then I will just make an executive decision. We'll go for Hub. There we go. Right. Then, welcome, Vos Demmers. That's me, as you can see. I still look like myself, mostly at least. My name is Jos. I work for Nextcloud. I'm one of the people who started this whole game in 2016. I do marketing, which is why they sent me to talk to all of you. I'm the one who hates talking least, or actually I kind of like it. And what I'm going to talk about, of course, today is Nextcloud and Nextcloud Hub. Now, I will walk you quickly through a little bit of the thoughts and ideas behind Nextcloud and Nextcloud Hub before I get to the actual technical meat. I hope that that will fit all your ideas of the world. And if not, then maybe you'll learn something new, which is also good. And usually when I talk about Nextcloud, I talk about privacy and what privacy means for an individual, why it is important, etc. And I've been given that talk here at Vosdem already a couple of times, and some of you might have seen it already. And I think with what's been happening lately in the world of, well, tech, you know, the revelation of the revelation of stuff, Facebook and Snowden and everything, I kind of think that most of you already know why privacy is important and why there is an issue with putting all your data in the cloud, as in with somebody else, etc. So I'm actually going to try and bring the conversation to a slightly different level, a little more, well, call it strategic. So today, most of the data that we as Europeans create by walking around, you create data on your phone, location data, by writing emails, you create data, by taking pictures, you do. Almost everything we do these days creates data somewhere. And that somewhere is usually, well, either here or there, and only very little is in Europe. And this is not to scale, because if it was to scale, then the EU would actually be much smaller. An estimate I read was that only 4% of the data that we generate stays in the EU. The rest goes either under jurisdiction of American companies or is physically in the US. Now, of course, this is mostly about who owns the data and controls it rather than where it physically is, because we all know the cloud is everywhere, right? Nobody can really say where it is. Not even these companies that run it themselves can pinpoint for every bit where it is and where the copies are and everything else. So what's the issue with this? Now, there's kind of a new term, a new name for this, and digital sovereignty is what you hear thrown around. And in Germany, they have been talking about this a fair bit, and what they have done is to start a project called Gaia-X. Nextcloud is involved in that a little bit, and that's one effort of trying to deal with this. Now you wonder, okay, what is the problem with this? Okay, privacy. Yeah, if you don't control your own data and somebody else does, then you know they know where you do, where you live, what you do, and all this stuff, and that has all the known implications for your life. But what does this mean for us as Europe, or for us as Belgium, or us as Germany, or even for companies? This has implications, because what happens with this data is, of course, there's a lot of money being earned with it today. But a part of what's being done with this is also that technology for tomorrow is being developed using our data from today. Yeah, I mean, what company in this world is best at recognizing faces in pictures? Facebook. Why? Well, we first gave them and then tagged for free for them all our pictures. So they have an enormous database with faces and names attached, and they can train neural networks better than any other company in the world. So if you're a startup here in Brussels and you want to build an AI that is better at recognizing pictures, where do you find a huge database of faces that are tagged and fully prepared? You can try to ask Google. They probably won't give it to you. They might even cite privacy concerns. So, you know, there is a bit of an issue here, right? If we want to build the next generation of self-driving cars here, in Germany, the car manufacturers are, in my opinion, not doing a great job at this at the moment. I feel they're falling behind. It's a problem for Europe. If we want to build the next generation of self-driving cars, we need data. Who is getting all this data at the moment? Any of you ever driven in a car with Android Auto? It's bloody convenient, right? Also, at least, I really like it. But, you know, all the data is being streamed directly to the US. They're already in a quite a nice position to build a self-driving car because they know where they are, how fast they drive, they know everything. That's why Google Maps is so good. They know everything. European companies will not be able to compete. And I mean, if the German car industry goes down in the next 10, 20 years because, well, they won't sell cars to individuals anymore, but 90% of the cars will probably be sold to companies like Uber because people will stop driving their own car because, I mean, you get these cars that are self-driving that Uber lends to you for like very little money for an hour. So owning a car, I don't know if you ever noticed, but most young people, and I mean the 20s, 25 people, a lot of them don't own a car anymore. Car ownership is going down like a rock and it's going to continue like that. So most cars are going to get sold to five big companies and they will have a buying power that will squeeze the companies that make cars until they have almost no profit. So they will stop innovating because you need money and profit to be able to innovate, well, and waste money on bureaucracy, which is also something they're really good at. So no innovation in Germany, no more profits being made in Germany. All the companies that deliver parts for these cars are also going to get squeezed because, you know, there are very little profits anymore. So the innovation in, you know, other parts of technology that are being delivered for these cars is going to get squeezed. The impact on the European economy is going to be huge. So we're not going to be able to do cars anymore, which is one of the last things I guess Europe still produces and does reasonably well. We're not going to be doing any of the new tech stuff because all the data we would need for it is in the US or in China. So what are we going to do next? I don't know. Buy the stuff from the others maybe. We're going to become kind of a franchise for American companies. So talking about strategic, this is a problem. That we collectively have. Businesses have this, but also governments. Now, this is what digital sovereignty is about. And of course, you know, there is a problem. We're here at, or a solution. We're here at FOSDEM. So obviously, open source is definitely going to be part of the answer to this. But as you might know, a lot of these neural network training technology and stuff, this is already open source. Google is happy to open source the neural network software, but not the training data, of course. So this is not completely the solution. One important thing is we need to take back control over our data. We need to make sure that it's hosted here, or at least under our control, by European companies, by Europeans, or, well, at least under our control. Now, obviously, there are many technologies we need for that. There will need to be networks of, like, OpenStack, and that kind of stuff to store massive amounts of data. The universities will need to start to take more control over this data. But of course, one part is we will need to have a place where normal people can put their data, where companies can put their data, where they're editing documents and, you know, working together, where they have video calls, where you're chatting with other people, where you're working with your calendar, your contacts, your mail. Well, one of those, obviously, that's why I'm here, is Nextcloud. We are building an open source, well, platform where you can put your files. And this is what you all know as Nextcloud. That's the platform where you put your files. You can share them with other people. You can add comments to your files, etc., etc. And of course, together with that, you have a couple of other apps that always have been coming with Nextcloud. You have the Photos app. You have an Activities app that you can see what happened to your files. And we introduced some time ago another app that you could install if you wanted to, which is Nextcloud Talk. Now you can have video calls and you can have chats with other people and install a mobile app so you can call other people on your phone, all via your own private Nextcloud. We have a mail client, we have a calendar, well, contacts, and a calendar app. So these pieces are here. And what we wanted to do was to change a little bit how Nextcloud presents itself. Because over time, Nextcloud was like you have the files thing, and then you install the others as apps. Yeah, and what you then get, as you probably know, is these apps in the top bar. As you can see here on top, yeah, you have all these different apps. Yeah. So the change we wanted to make was to actually move them, as you just saw in this nice animation, kind of on the same level. Nextcloud is no longer about files. Yeah, we are in 2020. Everybody expects to also be able to have a chat, to also be able to share a file in the chat room and edit it, to attach a file to a calendar item. So it's more become more and more important to have all the pieces in one place. And this is essentially what Nextcloud Hub is about. Yeah, the new name is in the end just a change in how we present what you get. When you install Nextcloud, from now on, there is a box on the bottom with a checkbox that is checked by default that says install recommended apps. And when you just continue, click, click, next, next, what you will get is all of these apps. You will be able to edit documents, to share files, but also to have a video call, a chat, create calendar, read your email with standard Nextcloud. Now, I'm going to go quickly through some of the changes in Nextcloud that we did on top of this change of making it kind of a bundle. And again, you can still, of course, not install some of these apps or use all the pieces separate. So, well, Nextcloud files, that's for the file management, uploading, downloading files, searching. Well, we have recommended files already for a while on top. So if somebody commented on a file or shared a file with you, you will immediately see it on top. You don't need to drill down in folders and just find it. There's a grid view, tagging, comments. You can see what happens to your files. And and the whole sharing, of course. We have a new sharing sidebar, but it looks rather similar to the old one, except for some minor changes. So I will skip that now. One option that we recently added is that you can choose that every time a file is shared with you, you have to accept it first. If you get a lot of stuff shared with you, that might not be nice, but if it's not so much, then this can be helpful. And you have the ability to hand up ownership of a folder or a file to somebody else, that it's really not just shared with them, but actually they own it now. That can be nice if you're moving between projects, for example, in a company or in a team. Now, the other big thing that we did is we call it workspaces or smart workspaces. And what it is above your folder is now a place where you can essentially put context to that folder. So you can explain what the folder is for, what it is about. And, you know, you can go pretty far. You can put the to-do list there. You can even put files in it and an image and other things. So if you're working with a group of people on the whole folder structure, you can actually explain what each folder is for so that your colleagues stop putting the wrong file in the wrong folder. You know, you always look for the contract. Some person puts them there, another one puts them there. Well, you can now yell at them right there on top. And this is also available on mobile. So on your Android phone, you can also see this and you can also edit this space. And it's even collaborative editor. It's built on Nextcloud Text, which we introduced in Nextcloud 17. So when you're editing that field, and somebody else start editing it too, no problem. You're just both editing at the same time. You see each other making changes. You can even see the other person's in there. And again, also works on mobile. So it's a complete collaborative solution. We introduced file locking. I mean, most of you probably know what that is. You can lock a file so that others know that you're working on it. And then, of course, they can ping you on the chat and say, hey, why did you lock the file? How long is it going to take? And when are you ready? That's where it gets, of course, really nice. Now, I have a nice video where I show all of this in action, but because of time, I'm going to skip that. Sorry, I'll play a video at the end, but it'll be a short one. So photos, we essentially rewrote the gallery app to make it a lot faster and nicer to use. Of course, it still looks largely similar, except you have now these nice sidebar. And when you're viewing a file, you can actually have a sidebar on the side, so you can even have a video call to discuss a file if you want. Nice thingy is that there's this community app called Maps, which is essentially kind of a Google Maps replacement, and it has integration with the file with the Photos app, so that you can actually see your photos based on the location where they were taken. Nextcloud Talk, that's a put your chat in one place, the decentralized chat in a way. And well, we rewrote the user interface here. It mostly is a lot snappier, but it's also nice that for the millennials among us, which is probably most, we now show emojis a bit bigger because, you know, colors. There's a reply feature as well, and the sidebar now has a search on top. So rather than having to scroll through the whole list to find that colleague, you can use a search, it filters. You can immediately start a new conversation. There's also a new dialogue for creating conversations, so you can easily step through two steps to have a conversation. And the lobby, which we introduced in 17, is of course still available. So you pick a time and date, and then until then, there's a lobby available for the people who are watching. The really cool video verification feature, of course, still working. So if you're sharing a file and you want to make sure that only the person who is supposed to get it gets it, instead of sending the password, maybe even via another channel, it's still impossible that a spouse or a kid has access to their phone. So with this feature, you actually first have to start a video call, and only then do you give access to the files. So you really are 100% sure that only the person you just talked to gets access to it, and not whoever got their hands on their phone. It's quite nice. Talk has commands, so you can do a poll or, you know, connect it to GitHub and get a warning when, a test fails. And of course, all of this is available on mobile as well. I'll skip this one because we have only a few minutes left. Calendar app, so we rewrote the calendar app as well. User interface, again, I mean, it's a calendar app. It looks like 2020, not like some of the others that look more like 1995, but it's still a calendar app. It has a couple of nice features. One of them that I personally really like is that when you're having a, when you create a meeting, you can create a talk room for the event. So there's just a button and then you click and then a talk room is created and added to the invitation so that you can have a call right there or a chat for the people who are joining. And of course, there's now a free busy view, which is something we really needed to add. And I think that is, create a talk room for this event. So Nextcloud Mail also made a whole bunch of steps forward. One of the nice new things in Mail that we did is actually it recognizes itineraries. So if you get a mail from, the train or airplane or travel company, then it gets recognized, added on top. And if you click on the plus button, you can actually immediately add it to the calendar. It's quite nice. And it supports, hundreds of different companies, but these are some of them. So it's a pretty cool thing. We did this together with the KDE community. I think there's a talk about it at FOSDEM, or there might be, not entirely sure, but it's pretty nice. And of course, there's a video of it, which you can see on our website, but I won't play it here. Nextcloud Flow is really nice. It's essentially the idea is to automate boring tasks. So you can do something like, somebody drops a file in a specific folder, there's a message in the chat room. Or, somebody uploads a file in that folder and it gets turned into a PDF and emailed to somebody else. These kind of features can now be configured in a pretty nice interface. We're still adding more actions to it, but there are like five or six at the moment. You can also run a script over a file automatically, so you can essentially do pretty much anything. And one of our developers is writing a app where you can just hit thingy on a server that you can connect it to external web APIs, and just a REST API is a thing that you can talk to it from other tools. So you could in theory use Nextcloud for your whole home automation, for example, if you want to. And the nice thing is, of course, you can combine these two because you can then describe what's going to happen in that folder just in top of the text on top of that folder, which is, of course, quite convenient. We had already a third-party developer integrate this. This is an app, I think it's called Data Analytics, and it can analyze a whole bunch of data, which can be updated live. And it can, for example, re-analyze the data when a file gets uploaded in a specific folder or gets updated. And it can also do actions like when the data hits a certain threshold, put a message in the chat room. These things, you can connect it into the whole system. All of this available is on mobile as well. For the desktop client, we have a new menu coming. I know I'm just spouting a lot of stuff because there's always so much happening in Nextcloud that it's really hard to keep it short, and we're also pretty much at the end of time. and I haven't even gotten to all the other apps yet. There are 200 of them in their app store. I'm kind of sorry for that, but I'm thinking I'm out of time and I just need to stop at 1 minute. Yeah, well, there we go. Look, we're essentially going after Office 365 with this. Yeah, we're trying to offer a real alternative to Office 365 that you can host yourself, that's 100% open source. As a business, of course, you can get support from us as a company. That's how we earn our money. But as a private user, run it on your Dropbox, etc. Now, we've seen all kinds of cool stuff that we have in this release. But some of you might think, well, there's one thing missing, because I still get these bloody Microsoft Office documents from people. And I still need to be able to edit them. Well, you can download them and then use the file locking. There is, of course, Collabora and only Office, which you can install if you know what a reverse proxy is. If you don't, you're kind of out of luck because it's really hard to install that stuff. Well, we solved that. So the biggest thing I think that we did for this release is that we essentially made a pig fly. We made only Office integrated in such a way that it's just one click and it works. No proxies, no configuration in Apache or Nginx, no Docker containers, nothing. Just it works. You can edit documents, Microsoft Office documents or ODT documents with other people, including a sidebar, have a chat or a video call while you're editing the document. It just bloody works. My time is up. Thank you all very much. Any time for questions or not?
4 minutes.
4 minutes. Well, what could not be answered in 4 minutes? Yes. So the question is if the only Office integration works on mobile. I haven't tested it yet, but it should. If it doesn't, it's a bug. We will fix it ASAP. Any more questions?
Are
yes.
You gonna integrate the mail server into it?
No, and we will not. Because honestly, Dovecot is perfectly fine, and there are others as well. And the strength of Nextcloud is, of course, the web interface or the end user experience where everything is integrated. And the backends of it, honestly, we don't want to do. There are other people who do that better. Our strength is in the user interface, where you can share a file directly into a chat room, where you can, you know, connect the chat room to a calendar item. We don't need to build a calendar server or a mail server. Other people do that better than we do. We build the user experience. Yeah. Any more questions? So the question is if you from Outlook can schedule an online meeting room in Nextcloud. And yes and no, there is an Outlook connector available. I don't think it has yet support for this feature that it can create a talk room automatically, so that you will still have to do manually. But being able to book resources like a meeting room, that feature should be there, even in Outlook, yes. Yes. Well, there's not a video, which I'm not going to be able to play. There are those apps I promised. Just one thing I wanted to say. All of this is available right now. Yeah, you can download all of it and it'll work. If there's not anything else.
Maybe.
Yeah.
You can create a package, like for a Debian package that you can just upget install Nextcloud instead of manually downloading sources.
So the question is if we're going to create like a package for example, Debian. What we try to do is to make a tarball that works for as many people as possible and leave the packages to the packagers. So even our Docker images and other things, they're created by the community. Yeah, I think that's the right model for us at the moment. We focus on making a nice interface. I have a nice video, but the problem is probably that there will be no sound. Well,
Nextcloud Hub.
Works.
Nextcloud Hub is the full content collaboration suite to manage all your documents and communications. An all-in-one worry-free package, so to speak. With Nextcloud Files, you can manage all your files and documents. You can download and upload. View and edit them. You can find everything with full text search and by tagging. And of course, you can share documents and collaborate with others. For example, with Carl, Paulette, Mickey, and many more at the same time. In Nextcloud Photos, you can find and view all your photos and videos. Just like this one. Oh, that was nice. In Nextcloud Talk, you can chat with others, work on documents, and even do audio and video calls, like in a real office. And best of all, you can even participate from your mobile phone. In the Nextcloud calendar, you can manage, share, and sync all your appointments with your phone and desktops.
Is there any more questions? Right now, I'll pause the video and...
But where's the number? Of course, in Contacts. In Nextcloud Contacts, you can view, manage, and share all your contacts. And of course, you can also form groups based on topics, just like my line dance group here. Yeehaw! In Nextcloud Mail, you can of course read, write, and manage your emails. There are also intelligent features like detection of itineraries. Nextcloud Hub even includes a full-featured office suite that lets you edit all your office documents together with others. Do you remember? Carl, Paulette, Mickey, here they are again. Nextcloud Hub is the powerful content collaboration platform with all the features you need. And by the way, the entire Nextcloud Hub is open source and can run on-premises, so you have control over your own data. Your cloud, your data. Nextcloud.
Well, that's the pitch. There are four more videos, but you'll have to go and watch them on our website. Thank you, everyone.